This is a research study I did with Nian-Sheng, and we presented preliminary results at the previous Open Ed conference in Barcelona last year, and we replicated the study 1 year later to make it more robust, and also in the hope that there would be some more positive results regarding the use of the open access press. But nevertheless, the results are positive in any case. Just to give you some background, the AU Press is Canada's first open access university press, and I think it's now been followed by the University of Ottawa. All the publications are peer-reviewed, so there's a very stringent quality control mechanism. And so far, our books have won at least 8 or 9 awards, either locally or internationally. And we just won a major international award for Head Smashed in Buffalo Jump. I'll be talking about that. We do books, monographs, and we also publish journals, the IRODL, the International Review of Research in Open and Distance Learning, the Canadian Distance Education Journal, etc. We look at innovative and experimental work, so there's some really strange and weird poetry works out there if you ever want to take a look at them. Diaries of pioneers in Western Canada, oral histories, etc., of women's oral histories in early Alberta, things like that, and e-learning. We have a series that's edited by Terry Anderson on e-learning. That gives you an idea of some of the books that have been coming out, and this is the one with the major awards that we mentioned, is Imagining Head Smashed In. It just won the Felicia Holton Book Award for Architecture Institute of America. And it's won an awards from the American Archaeology Society, the Alberta Book Publishing Award, and the Edmonton Book Prize. So that's just one example of the quality of the works that are there. And these three e-texts, the Terry Anderson's Theory and Practice of Online Learning, Muhammad Ali's Mobile Learning, and Dietmar Kennepol and Lawton's Teaching Science Online at a Distance. These have all won Wedemeyer Awards from the University Continuing Education Association in the US as the best distance education books. Scholarly journals, there's IRODL, there's the Canadian Journal of Learning Technology, the Journal of Distance Education, are all published by AU Press. We have a strategic partnership with PKP, the Public Knowledge Project, which is an open source book editor reviewing system, which is, we actually have contributed quite a bit to that project. And we're part of the Lois Hole Campus Alberta Digital Library, where they're creating a digital library for use by all the educational institutions in the province. We use the Creative Commons by non-commercial and no derivatives license. And the reason for that is, to give an example, is because it's non-commercial, we've just made a deal for translation of a number of these books with China, and it helps us to subsidize the press and help to pay our way, and particularly for the print books. So we use the Creative Commons license, the restricted one that I say there, and again, it's basically we sell the print books, and that's what I'm talking about today. Is we have sorry, yes?
Yeah, I had a question. The non-commercial, you said, made it easier to exchange this internationally, but what's the thinking behind the non-derivative?
Because these for example, it's a poetry book. The poets don't want you to touch it. Leave it as it is. And that's the standard license. Some of the books don't have the non-derivative, okay. And they're like the textbooks, the ones that are used as text.
Right, exactly.
But a lot of the, and like novels, thing.
So it's and biography. Topic and content
yeah.
specific.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just as we all know, non-derivative makes it tough to.
Yes, it does, yeah. And of course, the non-commercial is so we can sell it ourselves, so nobody else can sell it. China wouldn't pay us for it if we didn't have a non-commercial license on them. So yeah, attribution, non-commercial, and non-derivatives. So what we did was we wanted to see how did the sales of our print books compare with the sale of print books from traditional university presses. The traditional presses don't do digital books. So we surmised that there wouldn't be any difference between the sales of print books for that are openly available in a digital format and the print books that are produced by the traditional presses. And you cannot get the information. They will not do it. The other presses would not give us the information on their sales. So we don't know what their actual sales were. And we don't know what their sales were to libraries. So we can't compare them. But what we could do is look at their ranking on Amazon. And for every book on Amazon, there's a ranking. And the lower the number, the more the sales. And two people have done an estimate of what the rankings mean. And they're quite similar, so I think with a reasonable degree of confidence we can say that that's what the ranking means. So if it's between 1 and 10, you're selling about 3,000 copies a day, or greater than 1,000 copies per week. And it goes down the line, all the different rankings, so if you're 2 million, you're selling one copy every 3 or 4 years. So it gives you, it's a reasonable, if not exactly accurate measure of what their sales are, at least on Amazon. You're finding me at my talk. Most scholarly books are greater than 100,000. They move comparatively little in that, they're, whatever their range is. They decay relatively slowly. They're rough estimates, and they don't give stats for what the Kindle book sales are. So the methodology we used was a stratified random sampling. We used publications from 2008 to 2010. It was a limited sample because AU Press had just got off the ground and they didn't have that many books. So we couldn't do a really huge sampling. So we did AU Press and three other presses, 11 books each, three samplings separated by 3 months in the original one, and then we waited a year and did it again. And the comparison groups was the University of Alberta Press, University of Calgary Press, and the University of Toronto Press. And these three are very prestigious and probably they're among the largest university presses in Canada. So our prediction was the null hypothesis that there'd be no significant difference in sales of print books. That the rank of the open press would be equal to the rank of the traditional presses at a 5% level of significance. We made the alternative hypothesis that there is a difference, that the rank of open press is not equal to the rank of the traditional research presses. And so we did an analysis, and we came up, and the result was there. We did it three times, once separated by 3 months, and then again by a year. And in every time, there was no significant difference. The conclusion from that is by opening up your books and putting them, making them freely available online, it will not negatively affect your sales of print books. And in this particular situation, I think the ability to generalize it is sort of limited, but at least in this one case, using Amazon as a measure, that was the case. That print books, we can say that print books did not suffer in sales because they were also available digitally online. And that's the, and by the way, I should have mentioned, is we did it on both Amazon Canada and on Amazon.com in the United States. So we tested both, and in both there was no significant difference. And as you can imagine, most of the Canadian books did much better on Amazon CA than Amazon.com. But having said that, the other presses, you can't download the books. But the AU Press books were downloaded by more than 80,000 people. There were more than 80,000 downloads of different chapters or parts of books, and the full books, there were 20,000 downloads. An average of 6,000 per book, and an average of full books about 2,000. So what we can say is you can exponentially increase your readership by having it available digitally online for free, and again without penalizing your book sales.
Sir, I'm a little puzzled by your dates at the top. It says 6 months, but is that August of 2009?
August 09 to January of 11, yeah.
Isn't that closer to 18 months?
Yes, it is, yeah, sorry. Yeah, it's 18 months, yeah. So that gives you the results of the studies that we've done. And again, as I said, we reported on it after the 3 months, and now it's after 18 months. And we'll probably do it one more time to see. But the basic message is don't worry about opening up your books. And another benefit that we're looking into that we couldn't early on, but I think at this point we can, it may take another 5 years to really look at it, is the number of citations of your books. And we find that if it's online and available, your citation rate goes through the roof, and in comparison to traditional books and journals, if it's only available in print, yes.
How many university presses in the US are making open source these days?
I don't think there's any.
What are the other ones in Canada?
The only other one is the University of Ottawa Press that we know of. And to be honest, I don't know if there's any in Europe either. I think that Springer has something that is sort of old. Yes?
Is anyone talking with publicity people at academic presses to let them know about these statistics?
Oh yeah, we've let them know about these results because we have partnerships with these presses. Some of our books are also sold by the other presses. So they know this, but it's their traditional publishing mentality, and you know they have to change it. And in fact, when we set up AU Press, we had a huge battle to make it open. Our president, who came in at the time, who set it up, he wanted a university press. He was really, this was his baby. And but we fought with him to make it open. He didn't believe in it, but now he's a big believer in it. He goes about the world bragging about it. And the director of our AU Press is, he's invited to all over the world to talk about it because it's so revolutionary. And again, at the beginning, he didn't want anything to do with it being open. They wanted a traditional press, but there were enough of us in the university, thank God, that we pushed them, and they finally relented and said, okay, if that makes you happy, we'll do it. And it's working very well. Yes?
University of Florida is also doing open press through their Florida Business Learning Consortium, and it's a partnership between them and the University of Florida, and they're publishing some open textbooks through that. In fact, there's three or four coming out this year. So. there are other presses. I'm not sure if they're completely open, but they have the open, the Orange Grove Open Text Class site. So there are some other, which is a good sign.
Yeah, but most of them are, as you say, are for textbooks. These are only incidentally textbooks. They're scholarly works that are being used as textbooks.
So University of Florida has those as well, okay. Because their press has been around for a long time. Yeah. And I believe they are opening those up as well,
yeah.
But I don't know.
I'm surprised they don't catch on. I mean, the average scholarly article is read by 6 people. You open it up online, and the average is up in the hundreds. I mean, it makes that much of a difference, and sometimes the thousands. I mean, the graphs are really low, and then suddenly you put it online, and I just saw there was a report out about a press in England who last year opened it up, and they showed their readership and citations, and they were all really low, and then suddenly they opened it up, and it hit the roof. It made such a positive difference for them. And let's face it, for academics, I mean, you want it to be read and cited. That's more important than you're never going to make money on it. Yeah.
I work with the Public Knowledge Project that you're a partner with, and one of the things that we've really seen in the journal publishing is a lot more open access journal publishing,
right?
And we've seen a lot of scholars and academic libraries almost doing end runs around the traditional presses to get their word out, to get their work out and make it open. I think that we're going to start to see that happening in the area of monographs as well, where if the traditional university presses don't start to learn from your example, we're going to see those similar end runs where scholars are going to self-publish or they'll collaborate with their university library, who provide them with the technological services. So it's a critical time, I think, for a university press.
And I agree with that strategy. I'm finding you can't fight the copyright gurus head on. Your best is just ignore them. You know, go to OER, let them have all their digital rights management, and let them put it on. I know one thing at our university, the major things that are making our faculty move very quickly towards OER is, number one, they're bringing in very strict made in the US copyright laws in Canada with very strict measures of digital rights management, which will effectively take away all of our fair dealing rights. We won't have any. And number two, they're bringing in a copyright collective where we used to pay $3.50 to make course packs, and now they want $45 per full-time equivalent student. And no matter, even if our university had 100% open education resources, we'd have to still pay the $45 when another university used only proprietary material. And so they say you have to pay the same rate. And to us and to our faculty, they're beginning to see this is just crazy. And the really big thing is our faculty are beginning to get into with their students and to work on tablets. So our students, our course material is all online. They use tablets. And what we're finding with proprietary material, you can't copy, you can't paste, you can't highlight. You're not allowed to print it out, or they actually limit you to print out 5 pages once. You can't shift it from one computer to the other. Never mind format shifting, even in the same format, they won't let you do it. And then they have the dead date, where they just go into your computer and take it out. And all of these things are making people think, we can't work under those. You educators can't work with that kind of material. I mean, the other thing is, if you show your textbook to your wife or to anyone, you must immediately delete it from your tablet and notify them. And if you've clicked on that little license, you have agreed to do that. And you've also, by clicking on that license, also agreed that you have no fair use or fair dealing rights. So with all those things together, what it means is that we just can't work with that material. If it's proprietary, it can't work. So we're trying, and we're pushing in our university now, before you do any course creation, you go to OER and you do a search on OER. I mean, what a revolutionary idea for academics is, before doing anything, do a search for what's out there. You know, we train all our graduate students to do that, and they don't do it for their courses. So we're getting there. Yes?
Are there certain types of authors that you find are more apt to do this kind of work? Or are people pretty, anyone's pretty open to it, based on your experience?
I think it's just about anyone, because these are scholarly books. Nobody really expects to make any money out of them. So they just would love to get it published by a university press, which has been, and it's been peer reviewed. So there's somebody out there that said, yes, this is a worthy contribution to knowledge.
Rory, can you talk a little bit about, like, one of your press's books, like Imagine Head Smashed, just to give us an example of how that one played out, both online open access and sales in the print form. That seems like a really intriguing book that would have a much larger audience than your average scholarly publication.
Yeah, some of them are way up there. They're in the low lower than 100,000 rankings.
Uh-huh.
We haven't had any lower than 50,000.
Yeah.
But neither did any of the traditional presses either.
Yeah.
But one of them, that one's there, and the other big seller is Bomb Canada. It's called Views of Canada in the United States, how they view them in the whole book. It's quite funny, actually. So it's a big, it's a major seller in Canada.
So both of those books are two of your top sellers,
both
digitally and
And the other, like the other two are Sherry Emerson's book, because it's used as a textbook. And it's been translated into Chinese, as has Muhammad Ali's book on mobile learning. They're huge sellers as well. And people, I don't understand it myself. Mobile learning, why don't you download it, put it on your mobile device? But no, they want the paper. That was a big surprise to me. I scratched my head why anyone would buy the print copy of that. It's a huge seller. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I was going to ask, like, if you have any sense of different, like, what kinds of people are buying these print books and what kinds of people are downloading it, or it doesn't seem like maybe from the way you sampled that you're maybe able to tell, but that would be kind of interesting, at least for the
We didn't tell it, just from my own feelings about it, is the older people buy the book, the younger people put it on their tablet. That's what I'm thinking. But there's a lot of older people going to tablets now, so I wouldn't, you know, I'd say the research may contradict me completely, but just in my experience, people who've been brought up with books and people who are brought up now with tablets, there's going to be a big change. But I'm surprised how many older people, once they tried, we had the biggest, I want everything on pipe, our Cockney, one of our instructors, and he got a tablet, and he's got a different opinion on it now. He's not so sure. I think that's what did it, was the iPad has changed. We were struggling to get people really thinking and interested, you know. I had meetings, because we've been pushing mobile learning for 10 years. Mobile learning, who wants to learn on a mobile device? And, that's nonsense. Nobody's going to do that. And the tablet comes out, and now the whole atmosphere has changed. And in fact, I believe that most of us will be, at least in the developed countries, will be learning on mobile devices. And it'll probably be the tablet.
Yeah, because you can make the font larger.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. I can relate. But the other thing is, OpenCourseWare Consortium is going to present some statistics later on today about who your users are. Mm-hmm. And it turns out in the United States, I'm going to get the number wrong, but it's something like 30 or 40% of the people are 40 and up who use OpenCourseWare in the United States. It's different internationally.
Yeah.
But so don't count the old folks out yet. You're still learning.
No. But again, a lot of these, as I mentioned, the problems with e-books, I mean, it's a huge problem for education. But it's still even a problem for people who buy one. I mean, I just got a Mac Air, and I transferred an e-book that I bought over to my Mac Air, and iTunes took it off me. And they said, you don't have the legal right to use this. I had every legal right to do that.
You switch devices.
And they took it off me. I had to contact audible.com, and I got a number that gave me some secret code word. I gave it to Apple, and now it's back on. But I don't want to do that. Why should I have to do that? Why should I have to prove it? And you know, why do they have the right to go into my computer and take information away from me? I mean, this is, I think that the model has to change in some way. And you don't buy, and I think they're suing Amazon now for saying that you buy the book. Well, if it's a digital book, you don't buy it, you license it. And you license it under conditions that they have no rights to guarantee anything. They have no responsibility or liability whatsoever.
It's a 30-page term of agreements that you have to click to.
Yeah.
And who reads that?
Yeah, I do. I've read quite a few of them.
Yeah.
You know. And you do not sell your soul to the company. It's not that far. But one company did do that last April 1st. They put it in their license and everybody was clicking on it. They didn't realize it. Yeah, that we have your immortal soul.
I work in the K-12 sector here in Utah, and we have a couple of our high schools, some really large at-risk high schools that are using all digital tablets. We actually have iPads in one school and iPods in another, iTouches in another school. One of the things we're struggling with, we're finding a lot of e-books, but they're just text in nature, and kids are more... they are more likely to read those that are interactive. So what do you see in terms of, from a university level, ebooks being published that are highly interactive? The last one I saw, or the latest one I saw, was Al Gore's book, where you know you can actually touch the wind turbine. You can learn about it textually, and then you touch it, and you can actually see graphic representation, and you can see it. Movement and the energy levels and do all of this stuff that's really amazing. Those are the kinds of things that in K-12 we're trying to gravitate to, not only from a cost-saving perspective, but just cognitively it's a better form of learning. What do you see from a university level, a higher ed, of moving towards interactive text?
Well, we certainly are. We're in the process now of going through. We have about 200 interactive demos in different courses, little Flash or Java applications that demonstrate different points interactively. And we're in the process of going through them now and improving them and getting them ready, because we're going to put them on our OCWC site and make them available.
So you're seeing that grow exponentially.
Yeah, I see we're at the beginning stages of it. Okay. I think publishers are going to come up with these great books. And it's a shame we can't use them because of all the restrictive licensing, but we'd be too frightened to touch them. So it's up to us to start creating them. But you know, they say, well, where's the sustainability model? The sustainability model is we don't have one for the way it is now. Our province pays $78 million a year for textbooks for school. Well, we could create all the buy the full rights, copyright, everything for every single book in textbook, make it interactive for less than $78 million, and do it once, and then we can update it all the time for $5 or $10 million a year. And I don't know why the politicians don't see it. They're beginning to ask, though, because they realize that the present situation is unsustainable. Florida's doing big things, Washington State, Texas, I heard Indiana just recently, and California. So they're starting to think about it and get on, but that's where it's going.